Okay, so now we've done all of this, we've taken the rubber dam off and we're going to pull. There's always that one little bit of sneaky rubber dam that tears and it's stuck in there. And we want to pull that out. So do whatever you got to do that, but just don't leave it there. Okay, and you always want to get some air and really blow hard in between to make sure that the area is nice and clean. So next, I'm smoothing the gingival margin. Okay, so a lot of times we think that the gingival margin must be smooth from the matrix. It does not. Okay, you can have a massive overhang, you can still make it smooth. Injection, all those injection molding cases, people do, they end up with massive overhangs and they make them smooth. So here, now, before we bother making it smooth and pretty, we just want to make this bite good, because if we leave the bite high, one, the restoration will break, two, the patient will be unhappy, and three, it will possibly get sore. So don't be a chicken when you are doing occlusal reduction, because what will happen is you'll sit there and go, do like the most delicate little ballerina adjustments, and then you'll just be there for an hour. So look at how high the teeth are apart. So if they're like half a mil, just grind half a mil off, okay? That's half of a real millimeter, not a dental millimeter. Dental millimeters is like 10 of them to an actual millimeter. So if you ask a dentist to cut a millimeter off, they just like take 3 microns and then they go, is that enough? And they go, no, take a whole millimeter. So just grind it back. If it's slightly low, the patient will live, the tooth will erupt into position. If it's high, it's going to cause lots of problems. In fact, occlusal loading is the main reason that residents snap. So here we adjust all of this, and basically there's no point going on until this is perfect. Okay, it has to be, and you don't want light occlusion with carbon paper on a resin. You want no occlusion on the resin and all the occlusion on the tooth. It will move anyway over time, but you want it to start that way. And you can see here, I gotta go and go and go. And what happens is people give up. They go, I'm tired of this and I don't want to do any more adjustment and I want to go home. And then of course the patient is gonna call you the next day and you'll be fully booked and you'll still have to see them. So you may as well just do it now. If it's taking too long, then obviously get a new burr, because sometimes our finishing burrs get blunt and they take too long. Now I'm being absolutely certain that there's smoothness. You can check with floss. You can check it by blowing air in there so that you retract the tissues with the air and you can see it. You can do it by checking with your probe. I don't really care if it bleeds or if you traumatize the tissue at this point, it must be smooth, otherwise the tissue will be traumatized forever. Okay, and then you can see I'm flossing to just check any little areas around that. And you'll notice I've got this kind of methodical thing where I first got the occlusion right, then I'm getting all of the gingival margin right. I'm not bothering with the aesthetics until that's done. And doing the buccal, lingual, everywhere. And now I'm doing the shapes, okay? So I want to get this embrasure nice and deep, because that's what makes the tooth look like a tooth. And getting the shape of the incisal edge right as well. As you can see, mostly getting this done with the coarse disc. And then once again, putting our lines in. The lines just act guideline, because you can kind of easily lose your bearings. And now you can see I've got this super fine burr. It's just a very, very narrow tipped diamond burr, good for getting into proximal. You can't hit the tooth next door with it, so we'll fix. There'll be a little fine lip that we need to use the scalpel to smooth over, okay? And here in this case, I want to put a little bit of texture on and a little bit of a dent in there. I'm just gonna use a rubber point or a stone to do that, because it generally will do it with less scratching. If that's too slow, then we can use a burr. But burrs tend to leave scratches that are too heavy. So you end up with the scratches being like not natural like pericamata. They tend to be too, like someone got a burr and put fake scratches in it, which they did, but it doesn't look like nature. So we want to soften those out. And if we want a lot of scratches, we'll do that later with a slow speed burr. So generally getting it smoothed up. And the reason we want such chunky corners, so the reason we want to make it with like square corners, is because as we polish it, it will get rounder. With ceramics, completely different. So don't do this with ceramics. With ceramics, because they're so hard, you need to have it rounded before you start glazing. Now I'm just going to do a light polish because I want to be able to see the surface. And now I'm putting a bit more texture in. So the texture is coming from basically just using a burr. This is a slow speed diamond burr, and I'm just using it very slowly to put texture in. You can see I'm using both the side of it as well as the tip. The tip is running backwards and forwards. It's allowing us to get some very faint texture there that doesn't look like burrs. Okay, and now we polish. And the thing with polishing, when you want to try and keep the texture there, what you need to do is not, you normally go through a sequence of polishes. You start with the one that gets it like super medium fine, and then you go to the one that gets super fine. When you're trying to keep the texture, you need to go from the medium fine to the fine polisher very quickly, because you need to leave some texture on there and then just make it shiny. So in this case, we are just getting the leaving a little bit of texture there from that diamond burr, and then going a little bit with the medium polisher just to take the edge off things, and then we're going to the super fine polisher before we've fully removed all of that texture and we make all of that texture shiny. That's a key thing. If you're not trying to keep texture and you want it dead smooth, then you just get medium polisher until it's super smooth, as smooth as you can get it with this medium polisher, and then you move on to the fine polisher and you make that as smooth as you can. We also spend quite a lot of time on the palate side. A lot of times people forget to polish the palate side, and the patient won't see it, okay, but a lot of times dentists leave the palate side really bad, and the patient will just feel it and go, I feel really rough. And they'll just think, it will just put a bad feeling on how good the quality of the work is. So there you go. That's how I finish a composite restoration where I'm trying to get a little bit of texture. Now, with the video, you can't really see the texture because I haven't used side lights, but that texture was, you know, nice and subtle on the tooth. Thanks for watching. Bye.